you, Nivedita. I'd like to start by thanking the JNU Teachers Association for inviting me to this series of lectures. It's a privilege to be here in a very different role, not as a child growing up on campus, but as a part of a movement. I will only say that I would like to express solidarity with the students and faculty of JNU who are fighting for restoring the democratic traditions of JNU. And in this attack, JNU is not alone. Universities in everywhere in India, indeed in several parts of the world, and not just universities, other democratic spaces and institutions are under attack. And so we are living in challenging and difficult times. So we have to brace ourselves to fight those challenges. Let me now share a few thoughts about what I'm calling the new grammar of caste. Last year on the 15th of August, as the Prime Minister of the country was unfurling the national flag on the ramparts of the Red Fort and outlining his vision for what he thought India should look like, 1300 kilometers from Red Fort, an unprecedented and unparalleled event was taking place on the same day. This was in Una, in Gujarat, where thousands and thousands of Dalits and non-Dalits had gathered at the end of a 10-day journey, which was called the Dalit Asmita Yatra, the Dalit Pride March. These thousands of people had marched through several towns and congregated at Una. And the choice of Una was symbolic, because Una was the place, as we all know, where Dalit young men had been tied to a van and chained and thrashed for doing something that was a traditional occupation of their caste, which is skinning dead cattle and disposing of the carcasses. And for this job, which was their occupation, some men chained them to the van, thrashed them, proudly filmed that event and circulated it on social media as a matter of pride. That video went viral, we all saw it, and that led to a huge movement of protest. And what was being declared in Una that day, at the same time that the Prime Minister was outlining his vision for the nation, was a declaration of freedom and a declaration of independence, not from colonial authorities, but from the stigmatizing and dehumanizing occupations that kept those individuals, as well as millions and millions of Dalits, in a state of servitude and oppression. They vowed that they will never ever lift dead cattle and that they will not skin dead cattle. And they wanted freedom from these stigmatizing and humiliating occupations that had put them at the bottom of the socio-economic hierarchy for hundreds of years. They too unfurled the national flag. You know, anyone who protests these days is called an anti-national person. But what we have to remember is that in Una that day, they unfurled the national flag. They were the true nationalists. And that national flag was unfurled by the mother of Rohit Vemula, whose first death anniversary we observed yesterday. And unlike the Red Fort gathering, where school children had to be shoved into buses and brought there forcibly, in Una it was a spontaneous gathering, bursting at the seams. The point is that there is a lot of churning as far as caste disparities and caste dynamics and caste oppression is concerned. A churning that we need to understand, and that's what I'm calling the new grammar of caste. And one of the features of that flux or that churning is just as anti-caste atrocities increase, and one thinks that Ambedkar's vision of annihilation of caste is moving further and further away, that also lends fillip to the anti-caste movement. And it's this dialectic that has the potential to to eventually annihilate caste. And so that's... And it's that flux and dynamic that we need to understand about if we want to understand the caste contradictions and disparities today. Over the last 15 years, there have been several arguments that have been put forward when it comes to a discussion of caste disparities. One very popular argument or a very popular suggestion is that the Indian economy is now very much a part of the globalizing international economy. It's increasingly market oriented. The role of the state is reducing. And as the Indian economy formalizes and becomes increasingly integrated in a market setting, the view is that disparities such as caste that have their origin in an ancient system are likely to wither away. Why? What's the logic? Well, one, because the argument is that markets presumably have no incentive and no mechanism to discriminate on the basis of caste identity. So the argument is that identity-based discrimination is likely to decline. Okay? If there are foreign agents like multinational corporations that are entering the Indian economy and are establishing business, the argument is that they don't have the mechanism, and neither they neither have the mechanism nor the interest to ascertain individuals' caste identities and discriminate on the basis of caste when they're making their hiring decisions. As it becomes a market economy, discrimination on the basis of social identities, especially caste identities, is likely to decline. This is linked to the argument also that along with these changes, India is also becoming more urbanized. And unlike in rural settings, where it's easier to identify individuals' caste or jati, in urban settings, it's not always possible or individuals may not actually be interested in finding out. So when we travel on the metro or on the bus or we are having chai at Ganga Dhaba, we don't particularly care about who the person sitting next to us is. And we may not be actually interested in finding out, versus if we had been in a village, we would probably know the caste identities of those with whom we interact on a daily basis. So urbanization is expected to be this big development that is supposed to obliterate and mute caste identities. So that's one argument. The other argument that is also very, very prevalent in the literature is that since the early 1990s, since the Mandal Commission and the 73rd and 74th constitutional amendments, there is what Daffodil has called the silent revolution, which is there's been a rise of the so-called lower castes in the political arena. And you now find, ministers, leaders of political parties, chief ministers, etc., important political figures that belong to castes that have been historically and traditionally marginalized and discriminated against. So the argument is that some of the gains of that political representation must have translated into narrowing of the material distance between caste groups. And that must have translated into a reduction in discrimination. So both these arguments, and there are others that I'm not going into, but these are the two powerful strands of argument that indicate, that suggest that in over the last 20 years or so, caste disparities and caste discrimination must have declined. Right? So these are questions that I believe can be settled empirically. There is sufficient data in the public domain that we can look at, and what I'd like to suggest here is that we need an evidence-based discussion of these issues rather than discussion that is based on our preconceived notions. So let's start with the question of overall disparities, right? So if you look at any data set, any large data set, whether it's the census or the National Sample Survey or the India Human Development Survey, these are large nationally representative data sets, and take any slice of that, you will find the traditional hierarchies of upper castes, OBCs, scheduled caste and tribes, which are the administrative categories for Dalits and Adivasis. You find significant disparities in material indicators, whether it's educational attainment, occupational status, land ownership, income, monthly expenditure. So take any indicator of material status and you find significant disparities in between these broad caste groups. Well, you could argue that's not surprising because of the historical nature of discrimination that that we have seen in India. The question is not whether the disparities are present at any given cross-section, but what is happening to disparities over time. If the disparities exist but they are narrowing over time, that is, caste groups are converging towards one another, then that's the movement we want to see. So the surprising thing is not finding of disparities. What we really need to investigate is what has been the movement over time. I have done that in some of my work, and I've also talked about it in seminars here in JNU. I'm not going to describe the methodology, but all I want to say is that there have been a few studies that have talked about how Dalits, Adivasis on the one hand, and all other groups on the other hand, have seen a convergence in terms of material indicators. Well, it turns out that if you do this carefully enough, there isn't actually convergence. The only two indicators on which we see convergence are literacy, which is just the ability to read and write your name, and primary education. So all groups are increasing their literacy rates and primary education rates and are therefore moving towards each other. On all educational categories above primary, that's middle school, secondary school, higher secondary school, and graduates, you see actually a divergence between groups. That means groups are moving further apart, not towards each other. So that is as far as the trend, and this is, and you know, in our work, in my work, in one part of my work, we've actually looked at age cohorts born from 1947 to the present. So we have the entire 60, 70 years after Indian independence, and we actually find a divergence in terms of access to education. And we know very well that unless individuals have access to higher education, they cannot access formal sector, better paying jobs. So if there is divergence in the access to formal, to higher education, that's going to get reflected in access to white collar jobs, and indeed that is the case. So if you look at access to white collar jobs, you again find a divergence. Economists also have a way of estimating labor market discrimination, which means that you analyze wages that individuals are paid and try to see the difference in average wages or wages along the wage distribution. Try to see the difference, what part of the wage gap can be attributable to things like education, experience, age, etc., and what part cannot be so accounted. The part that cannot be accounted is seen as a proxy for labor market discrimination. If you do that exercise, you find actually that over the last 15 years, labor market discrimination, which means payment, wage payments in that group of employees that actually receive regular wages. So we are not talking about informal sector or casual or unpaid workers, etc. These are individuals who receive regular wages and salaries. If you examine that, then in fact there has been an increase in labor market discrimination over the last 20 years. And if you break this up into slices of wage brackets, then you find actually that the increase in this overall discrimination is accounted for by an increase in discrimination at the top end of the wage distribution. What does the top end of the wage distribution mean? These are individuals who earn the highest amongst all wage earners. This is the sector that swears by the name of merit or ability. We are constantly told that reservations are bad because they compromise on merit. But what we find is that when we account for merit and ability, you still find the highest gap that is unexplained at the top end of the distribution. So a sector that swears by the name of merit or meritocracy is one which is actually seen an increase in discrimination, which is an unaccounted for wage gap that cannot be accounted for by characteristics. That should give us something to pause and think about, which is, why is it that we see discrimination in a sector that's supposed to be meritocratic? I'll come to that in a minute, but this is one picture. Now, in the last, 10 years or so, we've also heard a parallel narrative which is saying that, okay, labor markets, wage markets discriminate, Dalits face discrimination in if they try to apply for jobs. Why should they apply for jobs? Be job givers, not job seekers. Have you heard this slogan? Okay. This is the slogan of the Dalit Industrial Chamber of Commerce and Industry, the DICI. Their slogan is, be job givers, not job seekers. So the point is, why apply for jobs if you're going to be discriminated against? Why not set up your own businesses and give jobs to other Dalits? Sounds good. And it sounds like that might be a way out of discrimination. And indeed, if you look at the website of the DICI, then you find that there are about 160 billionaires who are Dalits, who battle immense odds to reach the position that they've reached. And we must salute their efforts and their courage and the fact that they didn't kowtow to the institutional discriminatory structure and reach where they did. But in order to see whether Dalit capitalism or this slogan of be job givers, not job seekers, in order to see whether this can actually provide a way out of exploitation, we need to see a picture of all Dalits involved in self-employment or businesses, not just the top end of these Dalit millionaires. So I've also worked on that data, which is micro, small and medium industry enterprises data, which is a census, which is all businesses. And there you find actually that if you analyze that data, and this is now, we are talking about 15 lakh, 20 lakh data points. So these are, a very large data set. And if you analyze that, you find actually that Dalit businesses, Dalit owned businesses and Adivasi owned businesses are actually smaller. About 40% or so on average are own account enterprises, which means only one person runs it. So in other words, if there's a person selling chai alone, that would be counted as a business. So a very large number of Dalit enterprises are bottom of the rung, survivalist enterprises and not entrepreneurial at all. So it's not the end that the DICI is aiming at. And you can imagine that they were probably pushed to doing these survivalist activities because they couldn't get decent employment. So it's not an escape out of labor market discrimination. It's because of labor market discrimination and lack of access to education that individuals end up doing survivalist activities because they have to do something to survive. So the bulk of Dalit businesses don't follow the Dalit billionaire model, and they are in no position to actually be job givers. They are in that position. So there is a small upper crust to these businesses, but that's minuscule. The bulk of Dalit businesses are actually not in any position to provide other Dalits with a way of escaping labor market discrimination. And I'm not even going into the question of whether capitalism can, so the slogan is Dalit capitalism, and we have some insights from the black capitalism movement in the United States. I'm not even going into the question of whether that's a viable alternative, etc. That can be discussed another time, but let's assume it is. But even if it were to be, the reality is that today Dalit businesses don't have the wherewithal to provide jobs to other Dalits who are battling labor market discrimination. So it's in the labor market, we are characterized by discrimination. In the small business sector, majority of Dalits are not in the position to give jobs. We tried to analyze using another data set is just as there is labor market discrimination, which means that there's a wage gap that cannot be accounted for by characteristics, is there discrimination against Dalit business owners? So there are qualitative accounts. Professor Jodhka from your university has extensively documented discrimination against Dalit businessmen in Punjab, and there are other such accounts. We wanted to see, look at business earnings data and try to see whether there's discrimination, etc. Turns out that even in business earnings, if you decompose the business earnings, then in fact, Dalit, there is a part of the earnings gap that cannot be accounted for by characteristics. So not only do Dalits face discrimination in job markets, they also face discrimination when they become businessmen. And why not? I mean, when you think about it, why should one expect that a society and the institutional structure that discriminates against Dalits and Adivasis in the labor market, in the job market, why should those discriminatory tendencies be completely missing from the arena that business is occupied? There's a land market, there's a credit market, there's a consumer market. Why would you not see discrimination there? And indeed, you do in fact find data does support this view that there is in fact discrimination against Dalits in businesses. So the point is that, so then of course you come to the second question that I raised earlier, which is, well, but what about all the political representation? What about all the quotas? So there is an increase in political representation, there's an increase, not an increase in quotas, but there have been quotas in operation for so many years. Why hasn't that changed anything? Why do we still continue to find these disparities? Why do we continue to find divergence? Why do we continue to find discrimination? Is it not time for quotas to be abolished? Because obviously they're not doing their job. That's a standard question that gets asked. So here we need to understand that first of all, reservations or quotas in universities, colleges, and public sector jobs affects a very tiny part of the economy. A large part of the economy of jobs and even education, actually, the private education institutions are free from the purview of quotas. What quotas do, in my view, is that they increase the representation of groups that would otherwise not be represented in institutions of higher learning. So, in my view, they desegregate the elite. And in itself, I think that's a very, very important objective. But quotas or reservations cannot be seen and should not be seen as a magic wand that is going to solve the multifaceted nature of caste disparities. And when people say quotas have failed, what they're saying is that quotas didn't work like a magic wand. They didn't abolish poverty. They didn't redistribute land. They didn't, equalize access to health. Well, they were not meant to. There should have been other policies for that. So by expecting quotas to be a magic wand and then saying, look, they failed, I think that's unfair. Quotas should be assessed on the basis of what they were intended to do. It's a complex, multifaceted problem, and it needs a complex, multifaceted policy approach. Reservations in colleges and in jobs perform a particular role, which they do. But for all other problems, we need other policies. Now let's come to what quotas actually do. And what Rohit Vemmula's tragic suicide last year brought home to all of us with a shock is that quotas are only the first step. They provide access to a university seat. But because quotas are a policy that is politically not popular, and because access is mandatory, it's constitutionally mandated, so it has to be given, announcement of the quota is often seen, perhaps not in JNU, but certainly in other parts of the country, the announcement of a quota is often seen as the beginning and end of the affirmative action policy. So quotas are announced, individuals get admitted, and that's it. After that, the university or the institution or the college feels that they've done their job, and after that, if those who are admitted on quotas sink or swim or get assimilated or get discriminated or not. None of this is something that the institutions feel that they need to be concerned with. And what the Rohit Vemula episode reminds us is that we should see access to an institution, whether education or job, that means implementation of the first step of the quota, as only the beginning of affirmative action and not its end. You know, I was trying to get data on, you know, how many numbers of people have accessed quotas over the years, and you would think it's such an important government policy, so there must be a government institution or a department that keeps all this data. And I and my students have been at it for the last 5 months. And we have a data set, but it's full of so many gaps because we cannot find a single agency. And even the agency that are supposed to be monitoring these policies have absolutely no clue. And this is only at the central level. At the state government level, we file right to information applications. And from other than 5 or 6 states, all other states gave us back the application saying, we do not have the information that you're asking. So for such an important government policy on which there's so much attack, there is, in fact, the government does nothing by way of monitoring the progress of the reservation policy. So the reservation policy is in place because of historical reasons, and it's constitutionally mandated, so it has to be there. But there is a severe lack of political will and an understanding of what needs to be done after granting access. And that access is only the first step. So first, reservation is not a magic wand that is supposed to solve all problems. And even the limited problems that it's supposed to address, it's thwarted because of bureaucratic difficulties, because of political apathy, and because of just antipathy towards the policy. And what we need to have in place within education institutions particularly are a set of anti-discriminatory policies. And that was really, you know, if there's one lesson that we need in terms of policy from the Hyderabad incidents, it's that just as after a long struggle, we now have mandatory sexual harassment committees in institutions, we similarly need to be very alert towards caste discrimination, which until all these years, we thought didn't exist inside institutions. Right? But now we know that it does, and it's a very important problem that needs to be addressed. As far as political representation and its translation into alteration, you know, that's a very, very complicated process, and in no country does it happen within a few years. And yet, there are, in fact, very important studies that show that at the panchayat level and the local bodies level, there is a big difference that political representation, the 73rd and 74th amendments have made in order to improve the material standards of living of Dalits and Adivasis in the small panchayat area. At the national level, it hasn't happened yet, but that's a longer struggle. So basically, the point I'm just going to sum up now is that the churning that's taking place in terms of caste disparities is really seen in the middle level, which is the level of the other backward classes, the OBC category, and certain other dominant groups that are today asking for inclusion into the OBC category. So on the one hand, we see that the gaps between Dalits, Adivasis, and an increase in disparities and discrimination between the upper castes and Dalits and Adivasis. There is, in fact, all the fluxes in the middle. And there has been important flux in the middle, and about which the details of which I don't have time to go into today. But what I'd like to suggest is that this flux, this churning, is actually posing a new challenge now to the one policy that Dalits and Adivasis had in their favor, which is the quota policy. So today we have dominant communities like the Jats, Patels, Marathas, in Maharashtra, Kapus, on the streets asking to be categorized as OBCs so that they get access to reservations, the same kind that OBCs have gotten earlier. First, of course, we need to see whether these, on average, despite considerable differences within these communities, on average, what is the socioeconomic position of these groups? And it turns out, again, that if you look at the data, it turns out that on average, these groups are far from marginalized. In fact, their outcomes are closer to Brahmins and other forward castes in their respective states than they are to Dalits and Adivasis. Of course, having said that, we must recognize that there is a lot of differentiation within these communities, and these communities have also been affected by the overall changes that the Indian economy has gone through, particularly in the agrarian sector. So the agrarian crisis is affecting these communities as well, but not on an average scale. So on an average, they still remain far better off than the existing OBCs or Dalits or Adivasis in their respective states. The second point I'd like to make is that because of privatization of jobs and because of the fact that the total number of government jobs is actually declining, the limited entitlement of reservations for Dalits and Adivasis is already shrinking. In addition, if this instrument of reservations is opened up to groups that may not necessarily be marginalized, then in fact, I believe that it will end up eroding the very limited entitlement that Dalits have today in terms of a constitutional guarantee towards quotas. So instead of strengthening and deepening the quotas and working at post-access inclusion measures, and thinking about what kind of preferential or remedial measures can be adopted in the private sector, instead of that, now the entire focus has been either give us reservations or abolish reservations altogether. So the argument these communities are making that we are powerful, and if you don't give us reservations, then nobody gets it. Either we get it or nobody gets it. And I believe that that's yet another challenge in addition to all the other challenges that I talked about in terms of that little sliver that Dalits had and Adivasis had in terms of, I completely believe that this is not enough, but at least it is a tiny sliver which needs to be kept in place and protected. But these new demands and these changes are likely to further erode that limited entitlement. So there is a lot of churning, there's a lot of flux, and I'll only end by saying that we should analyze it in terms of material realities, not look at it in simple electoral terms about, you know, this political party benefiting from these many votes, etc. That may or may not happen, but it's a bigger churning that we need to understand and appreciate and continue to fight caste disparities and discrimination by producing a body of knowledge which is evidence-based, methodical and rigorous. Thank you very much.
My question is, आपने बताया SC/ST के reference में, there is another class called OBC, और OBC में भी एक और marginalized section है जिसका lower OBC, which is not electoral force, और उनका discrimination भी लगभग उसी level पर है जो Dalits के साथ है, but they are not that marginalized. So, आपकी इस पूरे conversation में वो मैं point missing पा रहा था, so if you can.
Ma'am, while I agree with the point that if reservation is extended into the private sector, there would be an increase in social justice, but considering that the private sector does not want any kind of constraints onto it, and where we are competing with other nations for generating employment in our countries, what would be a possible solution where we can have increase in social justice while having a better score and the ease of doing business in things?
जहाँ तक ये OBCs के अंदर का differentiation है, OBCs के बारे में असल में मैंने बात ही नहीं की, तो क्योंकि समय कम था, और हालांकि लेकिन ओबीसी पे मैंने और काम किया हुआ है और डेफिनेटली ये बात सच है कि ओबीसी के अंदर उनका इंटरनल डिफ्रेंसिएशन भी है. एक फर्क मैं सिर्फ करना चाहूंगी कि ऐसे द ओनली डिफरेंस इज दैट ऑक्यूपेशन दैट आर हैव बीन हिस्टोरिकली स्टिग्मेटाइजिंग एंड दोज दैट हैव बीन दैट हैव मेड सर्टेन ग्रुप्स अनटचेबल. तो जो अनटचेबिलिटी का स्टिग्मा है वो चाहे आप वो व्यक्ति वो काम ना भी कर रहा हो तभी भी रहता है, कई साल लगते हैं उस स्टिग्मा जाने में. तो उस स्टिग्मा को समझना बहुत जरूरी है. और जब हम ओबीसी और दलित की कंपैरिजन करते हैं तो एक तो मटेरियल इंडिकेटर्स हैं लेकिन उसके अलावा उनके हिस्टोरिकल ऑक्यूपेशंस क्या थे और क्या वो स्टिग्मेटाइजिंग थे कि नहीं, वो भी एक चीज समझनी जरूरी है. लेकिन आपकी बात बिल्कुल सही है कि आज के लेक्चर में मैंने ओबीसी के बारे में कुछ विशेष, आधा ही घंटा था तो नहीं कर पाई, लेकिन किसी वक्त आपसे बात करेंगे. रिजर्वेशन एंड प्राइवेट सेक्टर एफिशिएंसी, वेल इट्स प्रॉब्ली अ वेरी लॉन्ग आंसर बट आई गिव यू अ वेरी शॉर्ट वन. See, the point is that when individuals get discriminated on account of their social identity, which what that means is that talented individuals, if they belong to groups that are discriminated against, are unlikely to find jobs. And the other side of the coin is not very talented individuals of the dominant groups end up getting jobs. So even from the point of view of efficiency, discrimination is not a very efficient system. So even if you want to increase, just forget about social justice, even if you want the efficiency of the private sector to increase, then it must actually attract the best talent, and the best talent is distributed across all groups. Therefore, to view reservations as of any preferential form, we can discuss what exact form needs to be devised for the private sector, but any preferential form, well, call it diversity, call it reservations, call it preferential policies, whatever, actually will end up increasing the efficiency of the private sector. As far as total employment generation is concerned, reservations don't increase employment. What they do is they alter the distribution of employment. For overall employment, you have to look at the larger macroeconomic concerns. So if employment is not growing in India today, if you have a jobless growth, then that is something we need to talk about independently. Reservations are not responsible for that. कोटा से टोटल एम्प्लॉयमेंट नहीं बढ़ता है या कम नहीं होता है. टोटल एम्प्लॉयमेंट जो भी है उसकी वजह होती है मैक्रो इकोनॉमी में होती है. तो यदि नौकरियां नहीं बढ़ रही हैं तो उसकी क्या वजह है? हमारी इकोनॉमिक पॉलिसी में ऐसी कौन सी कमियां हैं जिसकी वजह से वो टोटल एम्प्लॉयमेंट नहीं बढ़ रहा है? उस पर किसी और दिन बात करेंगे. लेकिन सवाल यह है कि यदि नौकरियां नहीं बढ़ रही हैं तो रिजर्वेशन अच्छा है, रखें या ना रखें, लोगों को नौकरी तो मिलेगी नहीं. लेबर फोर्स तो बढ़ रहा है आपका और नौकरियां आपकी नहीं बढ़ रही है ना, तो रिजर्वेशन से तो उस पर कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा. और जहां तक रिजर्वेशन हुआ या प्रेफरेंशियल ट्रीटमेंट हुआ या डाइवर्सिटी हुआ या एंटी डिस्क्रिमिनेटरी पॉलिसीज हुआ, उसकी वजह से एक्चुअली प्राइवेट सेक्टर का एफिशिएंसी बढ़ेगी, कम नहीं होगी.
Truly a very, very great honor to have with us Mr. Vedvada Wilson, who is